social distancing things here. So we ask that you sit in every other pew. The offering was listed in the order of service in our bulletin. We won't hold it at this time. And we ask that you simply drop off your offerings and lay off in the basket in the back of the church. The entire service is in the bulletin, so you have no need to touch a hymnal. We'll continue that practice throughout the duration. You turn to page 3 in our bulletins and we stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thus says God, the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and what comes from it, who gives breath to the people on it and spirit to those who walk in it. I am the Lord. I have called you in righteousness. I will take you by the hand and keep you. I will give you as a covenant for the people, a light for the nations. To open the eyes that are blind, to bring out the prisoners from the dungeon, from the prison those who sit in darkness.
Thank you.
a long time I have held my peace. I have kept still and restrained myself. Now I will cry out like a woman in labor. I will gasp and pant. I will lay waste mountains and hills and dry up all their vegetation. I will turn the rivers into islands and dry up the pools. I will lead the blind in a way they do not know, and paths they have not known, I will guide them. I will turn the darkness before them into light, the rough places into level ground. These are the things I do, and I do not forsake them. They are turned back and utterly put to shame who trust in carved idols, who say to metal images, "You are our gods." Hear, you deaf, and look, you blind, that you may see, who is blind but my servant, or deaf as my messenger who I send. Who is blind as my dedicated one, or blind as the servant of the Lord? He sees many things, but does not observe them. His ears are open, but he does not hear. The Lord was pleased for his righteousness' sake to magnify his law and make it glorious. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading today comes from Ephesians chapter 5. For at one time you were darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true. And try to discern what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to speak of the things that they do in secret. But when anything is exposed by the light, it becomes visible. For anything that becomes visible is light, therefore it says, "Awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand. With you is the fountain of life.
In your eyes, you see my life.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 9th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
As Jesus passed by, he saw a man blind from birth, and his disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "It was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." Having said these things, he spat on the ground and made mud with his saliva. Then he anointed the man's eyes with the mud and said to him, "Go, wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. So he went and washed and came back seeing. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar were saying, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some said, "It is he." Others said, "No, but he is like him." But he kept saying, "I am the man." So they said to him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made mud and anointed my eyes and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' So I went and washed and received my sight." Then said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I do not know." They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was the Sabbath day when Jesus made mud and opened his eyes. So the Pharisees again asked him how he had received his sight. And he said to them, "He put mud on my eyes, and I washed, and I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath." The others said, "How can a man who is a sinner do such signs?" And there was a division among them. So they said to the blind man, "What do you say about him, since he has opened your eyes?" He said, "He is a prophet." The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had been received his sight until they called the parents of the man who received his sight and asked them, "Is this your son, who you say was born blind? How then does he see now?" His parents answered, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but he now sees, and we do not know, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him, he is of age, he will speak for himself. His parents said these things because they feared the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that if anyone should confess Jesus to be Christ, he was to be put out of the synagogue. Therefore his parents said to him, he is of age, ask him. So the second time they called the man who had been blind and said to him, give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner. He answered, whether he is a sinner, I do not know. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see. They said to him, What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? He answered them, I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples? And they reviled him, saying, You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from. The man answered, why, this is an amazing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but if anyone is a worshiper of God and does his will, God listens to him. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. They answered him, you were born in utter sin, and you would teach us? And they cast him out. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and having found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? He answered, and who is he, sir, that I may believe in him? Jesus said to him, you have seen him, and he is the one who is speaking to you. He said, Lord, I believe, and he worshipped him. Jesus said, for judgment I come into this world, that those who do not see may see, and those who may see may become blind. Some of the Pharisees near him heard these things and said to him, are we also blind? Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would have no guilt. But now that you say, we see, your guilt remains. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated as we sing our sermon hymn, found on page 12.
trust in Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Do you have a sense these days of what it is to be blind? Not, of course, physically blind, but blind in the sense of not knowing what is in front of you, not knowing what is to come. We all have. Who knows what's going to happen today or tomorrow? Those of you who look at our Facebook page know that I posted a video there, and an hour after I made that video, another executive order came out that tells people in St. Louis County and the city that basically it's a shelter-in-place order. So now we have to reassess what again we will do in the next day or days or minutes to move forward. And I'm sure it is somewhat that way in your life too. What's to become of your job? What's to become our life here together as a congregation? What about our towns, our communities, even our nation? Blindness is something that affects all of us in some way, shape, or form. So perhaps we can relate to this man who had been blind from birth. It is interesting that it is a theological question that allows Jesus to provide an answer that we get to live with in our day and age. The man is blind. Blindness is a result of sin in our world. Whose sin? If it is his sin and he is blind from birth, what did he do? Did he do something in the womb that was so evil that God afflicted him in this way? Or was it his parents who did what was evil? And God is punishing him and them through their actions. We have an interesting discussion about those things, but Jesus is not interested in a discussion. Instead, he is interested in bringing light into the world. It was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. Now we often take this to mean Jesus is going to heal this man, and we will see that Jesus is God, and see the works that he does, and that these are the works of God, and therefore we should trust in Jesus. That's a great way to look at this. But we can add to that as well. Promise of the Old Testament that when God would send his servant, he would bring people out of darkness and into light. I often wonder if God is not using our present crisis for just such a thing. We are a consumer-driven society, and pretty much a consumer-driven world. What happens when you can't buy and sell? We don't know what the Lord has in mind right now. There could be so many things. Perhaps there is a great sifting taking place. Perhaps the Lord will use this calamity to lead people back to faith. That people who trusted in their consumerism, who say to metal images, "You are our gods," who trust in carved idols, maybe they will rethink. So we have an opportunity to reach out to them and say, there is another light besides the darkness you call light. And his name is Jesus. That would be a work of God, wouldn't it? When God works, often seems like darkness to the world, but truly is light. The light most fully came to us on the darkest day in human history. The Son of God himself died upon the cross. Darkness covered the face of the earth for 3 hours. The weight of the world was upon him, as he became the blind servant for us, suffered in our place, and died. That very darkness is our light. The resurrection proves it. Risen from the dead, Jesus now proclaims to you. Holy Spirit brings light and life to you and to me, even in the midst of this darkness. But here's the thing. Very often in the world, the light that we receive causes problems, causes trouble. Look at our man in the reading. That poor guy. He was healed by Jesus and he rejoiced. We are brought to faith in Christ Jesus. We are enlightened by the power of the Holy Spirit to trust in our Savior. The next thing that happened for that man is trouble. People didn't believe him. People accused him of all sorts of things. They even went after his parents. And because they feared their peers would say and do, they deflected things. You go talk to him. You go talk to him. And again, an opportunity for ministry and mission comes and evangelism. He made me blind who was blind to see. How about you? And he stubbornly insisted on testifying to the truth that had been done to him, the reality that he knew, even in the way those who insisted that his salvation didn't happen, that Jesus wasn't the same, that Jesus had not a mirror. And we know for this man that in the end things got better. He confessed faith in Jesus Christ, so we know that this very day he lives with God in heaven. The outcome for him, even though at that time he had to bear a cross for his faith. It may be that way for us as well. There may be those who ridicule you at this time. Why do you continue to trust this one, this Jesus? After all, if God had wanted to, he could have prevented this coronavirus from happening at all. What kind of God would send such a thing upon us? How can you trust in him? I think we're right to say, well, he made me to see. I once was blind, and now I see. Go take it up with him. Your troubles, your anger, your fear. Take it up with him. Not because you'll have something to say to get rid of your anger and you'll feel better about it. Not because maybe you can show him better, but take it up with him because he wants to save you too. He wants you to live in the light. He wants your salvation. And of course, that's what's really going on with this miracle. There's a metaphorical quality about it, isn't there? There's a real thing that happens. A man who's really blind is really given his sight. But the purpose of that real thing is to impart a more important and spiritual reality. That in Jesus Christ, we have the light of the world. And by trusting in him, we see. We see our salvation. We see our forgiveness. We even see what is to come in the days ahead. Not a detail by detail, then will Executive Order 15, 16, 17 come out. But in the sense that our future is secure. That even if we are to catch this disease, and even should the worst happen, the end is the best. Because we will be translated from this dying world into life with God. And we will, on the last day, with all the dead be raised, with all those who believe in Jesus Christ, we will be given eternal life. And so we see now. We see that we do not need to be afraid. We see that we can reach out to our neighbor in love just as Jesus reached out to this man and help in whatever ways we can. We can see our Christian duty. We can see the life that has been given to us. And that is a movement from darkness to light. So during these days, pray, reach out in love to your brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ. Reach out to those who do not know him. Now is a great opportunity to say Jesus Christ is the light of the world. And he truly is. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding will keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Our service continues as we confess together the Apostles' Creed. You can find it on page 12 in our bulletin. After the creed, please remain standing for the prayer of the church. We stand. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God.